Okay, so hi everyone. As Sagar said, I'm Neha. I work at the conservation department at BNHS, and I've been studying insects, diversity and ecology since my master's. And butterflies or odonates are my main area of interest. So today we are going to have a brief look at what odonates are, what their diversity, and what common species do we found in and around Mumbai. Okay, so as most of you might be familiar with dragonflies and damselflies as a part of their childhood memories. Some of you have might have played them with catching them, tying knot to their tails, and see them how they fly. So that's one of the memories of dragonflies or damselflies that we have, or just chasing them into the grasslands and around the ponds and lake in our surroundings. So dragonflies just not a part of our childhoods, but nowadays they're also a part of our art and various merchandise, as you can see over here. So we have different printings, printed mugs of them. Then we have different merchandise, like you can see over here, the pendant, the earrings. They're also in various art forms, like this one, Rangoli. And also in different art forms, such as this one, the right. Can you see the mouse or the pointer?
Hello?
Yes, Neha, there's a problem.
Yeah, I was asking, can you see the pointer or my cursor over here?
Yes. Yes, yes.
Okay, yeah. So this drawing is by one of my colleagues, Ms. Parveen, and she drew this beautiful zentangle for one of our gatherings. This is a zentangle of a damselfly. Then there are various scientific illustrations on which nowadays dragonflies and damselflies are used, as you can see over here. So some of you might be familiar with this journal called the Journal of Threatened Taxa. So dragonflies illustrations were a part of their page, one of their issues. Okay. So this was a brief general information on how we can relate to them. So now when it comes to the scientific studies, so both the dragonflies and damselflies together are called as odonates, and they are part of this order. Basically, dragonflies and both damselflies are like subgroups of a bigger group called as odonata. Just to tell you the brief meaning of it, the jaws of these insects or these animals have a teeth-like small structures. That's why they are called as odonates. And let's see how they are differentiated, why dragonflies are different from damselflies and vice versa. As you can see over here, this dragonflies group is called as Anisoptera. That means if you see these wings, so as insects, basically insects have two pairs of wings. These wings, one on right side and one on the left side, on the fore part, which is present on the anterior part of the body, those are called as forewings. And these ones, on the back, those are called as hindwings. Okay. So in case of dragonflies, they are not of equal size and shape. They are different, as you can see over here. And I've also written over here, the hindwings are broader at base. And they are not of, the forewings and hindwings are not of equal size. As in case of damselflies, the wings are narrow at base, and more or less they are equal in shape and size. And in overall appearance, dragonflies are stout, they are strongly built, and they are strong flyers. As opposed to dragonflies, they are delicate, they are comparatively weak flyers, and they do not wander away very far. Some of them, at least, yeah. So let's go ahead. Okay, so dragonflies are also interesting from the evolution point of view, as you can see over here. So dragonflies were the first insects to be able to fly, that had ability to fly. And before that, during the course of evolution, there were insects, but they could not fly. And so at that time, when the dragonflies and damselflies originated, that time was somewhere around 300 million years ago. If you have studied the age of the Earth, so it's like Earth is 4.6 billion years old. So from that, dragonflies came into existence around these many years ago. And that was a time when the Earth was dominated by fern trees. There were lots of swamps around, lots of marshy areas around. And that time, in general, the sizes of animals on land were huge. They were huge in size. So as you can see over here, this is an imprint of a dragonfly that existed, that was known to be existed during the Carboniferous period. That had a wingspan of about 60 to 70 centimeters. This is one dragonfly belonged to Meganeura genus. So this is one imprint on the rock that was, scientists got it as a fossil. And just to give you a comparison, as compared to today's man, if the man is like 2 meter height of 1.8 meter height, then this dragonfly would be of this size, you know, this huge. And there are various reasons for this phenomenon, like why they were so huge, and how were they surviving, what were they prey. So these are all, there are different reasons for that, but basically they say that the oxygen levels in the environment were very high. So that's why the overall body size of the animals was huge. So this is the artistic illustration of that period. How would it look like? So these are the ferns. As I said, the Earth was dominated by ferns, and you can compare the dragonflies as compared to the today's dragonflies. So today's dragonflies are much more smaller. Yeah. So that was a bit of evolution about the dragonflies and damselflies. If you can see the screen completely. I would like to tell you in brief, because these terms I will be using a lot in further slides. So it's a brief description of how insects had developed, or how their development is. So there are some insects jinmein pura metamorphosis hota hai, or the life cycle is complete. Complete means they are having four life stages, including eggs. Like as you see over here, in case of butterflies, you have eggs, then you have larva or caterpillar, then you have this resting stage of tallest pupa, and then you have adult. So these four stages are there as a complete life cycle. In case of other incomplete life cycle that dragonflies and some other insects have, like bugs and grasshoppers, so have this incomplete life cycle. They lack this resting stage of pupa. So there are eggs. The female, basically the adult, lays eggs that develops into the larva, and the larva slowly, after shedding out its skin 4 to 5 times or maybe more than that, it becomes an adult with the properly developed wings. So there are three stages, as you can see here. There are three stages: eggs, larva, and then directly adult. And the larva kind of resembles the adult, but it doesn't have the wings, obviously. And as you can see over here, these are semi-aquatic insects. So why semi-aquatic? Because half of their life cycle is completed in the water, inside the water. And that's why water is very, very much essential for their life cycle as a very first primary resource. And then there is vegetation for damselflies. As you can see over here, damselflies lay eggs, and dragonflies lay eggs into the water, and then the larva forms. In case of damselflies, it looks like this. In case of dragonflies, it looks like this. We'll see some more pictures ahead. So basically, it transforms into the adult. But the water is very much important. That's why these are called as semi-aquatic insects. And the larvae are predatory in nature. So dragonflies, damselflies in general, like other insects, are completely carnivorous in nature. So there are also differences in case of dragonfly larvae and damselfly larvae. Sagar, let me just ask you, is it going too fast or is it okay?
No, it is okay. It is okay, Neha.
It's okay. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, coming back to the larval forms of dragonfly, as you can see over here, as the adult was more robust and strongly built, you can also see over here that the larvae of dragonflies are also very strongly built in nature as compared to this one, the damselflies, the right one. Okay, these are more delicate, these are more slenderly built, and these are more robust, and they look very ferocious, and they are also. And also there is a second difference that their respiratory organs through which they respire, the gills, in case of dragonflies, they are not visible outside the body, whereas you can see, if you can see in this picture, these rounded structure at the end or the posterior end, these are the gills. So these are nothing but the respiratory organs through which they fire, and also it also helps them in case of dragonfly. They take in water from the mouth and leave it from the posterior end, at this called as jet propulsion reaction, that helps them to go forward when they are walking on the lower surface or the bottom of the water body. So these are the differences, but mainly these are very ferocious and these are very notorious insects, because as you can see over here, so let me just go back. Okay, so if you see this part, these are eyes, these are the antennae, and it's not very clear, but the mouth parts are kind of attached to the lower side of the body, on the ventral side, and it laterally it looks like this. These are the antennae, these are eyes, and these are the mouth organs, mouth parts, which are retractable. In both in case of dragonflies and damselflies, they can retract, seize their prey, and they can, you know, pull it back, just like chameleon, like what chameleons catches its prey with its tongue. It's retract, right? And in similar fashion, they seize their prey, and they actually seize their prey like this. So they are cannibal. That means they also feed on their similar species.
Hello, Neha, you're not audible. Neha? Apologies for the inconvenience. We'll get back to the speaker in a minute. And
yeah. Hi.
Hi, Neha.
Hi. Oh, I'm sorry for the connection.
Minor. Network glitch, I guess.
Yeah, so we were here, right? Yeah. Okay.
Wait, we cannot see this. Yeah, we see this slide now.
Yeah, so we were discussing about the different larval forms. So so basically, different larvae of different species of dragonflies as well as damselflies have different surviving strategies. Basically, when they are in the water, before becoming an adult, the water body, there are various competitors, there are various predators around. So they need to develop some defensive strategies to, you know, survive and also to find their prey. So over here, you can see some of them have different habits, like some of them bury themselves into the sediments so that they not be seen by the predators easily. Some of them just hang on to some vegetation or some pebble-like structure or gravel-like structure. So most of the damselflies are called as claspers. So there are different types based on their habits. most of the dragonflies are called as claspers because basically damselflies need a lot of vegetation around them because their body is you know, developed like that. They need to clasp on something. They need to clasp on some vegetation. And that's also you can see over here. The other larvae of dragonflies are free moving into the pebbles or the soil. But these need some kind of vegetation to, you know, clasp. So these are claspers. Then there are some dragonfly larvae which are called as sprawlers. Basically, they move on the bottom of the water body on pebbles or gravels. And they very much look alike their surrounding environment, basically camouflaging texture, they, coloring they have, so that they can be concealed easily and cannot be easily seen by their predators. So some are sprawlers, then some are hiders. As you can see here, I've marked it around that. So here is the head part, and here is the posterior part of the larva. Maybe you can see these two eyes now when I'm pointing it out. So it is that much camouflaging. And this larva is of a dragonfly which is called as ditch jewel. Basically, this species is found in kind of polluted waters. It can also be found in clean waters. But this presence of this species indicates that the water is not that much clear, or water might be polluted. Okay, so basically that's why the larva has developed this kind of habit of concealing itself into the sediment or into the soil that is present. Because in polluted water, there are a lot of sediments as compared to the other habitats like streams or rivers, where there are more gravel or sand-like structures are there. So the bigger dragonflies, the larvae of the bigger dragonflies like the gongfish or the clubtails, they have these kind of burrower kind of larvae. So regarding this, I would like to show you a video briefly how their habit is. Just a second. Okay, Sagar, is it visible?
What do you want?
Yeah, so is my screen visible?
Yes, the screen is visible.
Yeah. Okay, so this is the video I would like to show of one dragonfly species, the larva, that is called a common hooktail. Okay, so that comes into the category of burrower. And here my friend who studies taxonomy, larval morphology, and he has shot these videos and images of all the larvae. And he has given me these videos. So just have a look. See? This is how they burrow into the
No, we cannot
the
see
gravel.
The video, Neha. We can oh, only okay. see the presentation.
Oh, you can only see the presentation. Just a second. Okay, maybe I'll show you the video at the end. Maybe that will help.
Yes, somehow. Good.
Yeah. Okay, I'll show you the video at the end. Okay, so moving on to the habits of adult dragonflies and damselflies. So as we saw that larvae have this special structures for feeding. Adults only adults have jaws or the mandibles as I have. And they seize their prey like this. And they only, the characteristic of dragonflies and damselflies that they live prey and not the dead prey. And they are also they're helping us in a way to the humans because they also feed on a lot of mosquitoes. As you can see, this is a damselfly Coromandel mastard. And this thing is a mosquito. It is half eaten when I was taking this image, and
hello Neha. Yeah, trying to get back to Neha. Hi Neha.
Hello.
Yes, Neha, we can hear you.
Can you see my screen?
Sorry?
Can you see the screen?
No, not yet.
Okay, one second. Okay. Now is it visible?
Yes.
Okay. So these are the habitats in which odonates live or they prefer to be. So there are a range of habitats. They are also found in cities around us, as well as some of the species are very restricted to the forested areas, to the hill streams. As you see over here, the top left photo. So it's a fast flowing stream. This one, top right, is a standing water body. This is a marshy habitat. This is very suitable for damselflies because it has a lot of aquatic vegetation, which is suitable for their egg laying. Then the bottom left is just a temporary pond created in paddy field, as you can see over here. And this was taken in post-monsoon, so you can see that a lot of green grass is there. And this is basically the best season for any insects for breeding. And this one is, the last one is a lake. So again, a very standing, static water body, but it's a huge lake. So again, some dragonflies, some species of dragonflies prefer such, you know, non-flowing water bodies or static water bodies. And all these habitats basically are important for them because according to their requirement, according to the habitat, they have a specialized to particular habitat. As we saw in case of damselfly larvae, they need aquatic vegetation to class pond, right? So that's why these marshy habitats are very important for them. These are some examples of some representatives of dragonflies and damselflies that we are going to see. So the largest family is of skimmers, marsh hawks, or gliders, the oldest we believe today. So won't go into the scientific terms very much, but these are different kinds of them. So generally, Libellulidae are found around the static water bodies, like ponds and lakes. They're also found around the streams. So this one, crimson marsh glider, or the yellow-tailed ashiskimmer, those are also found around the lakes and sometimes around a very, you know, slow moving stream. This is a long leg marsh glider. As you can see over here, the legs are, the hind legs of this species are long, that's why it is called like that. So this again, the species also along the lake where it's photographed. And this is again one very common species that is called a ground skimmer. So the ground skimmer you will also see in the parks sometimes, because if your park has a small pond or a water body nearby, then these dragonflies will also wander around and come to the green grassy patches. So these are also found apart from the, away from the bodies. While
hello, Neha.
Hello. Yeah.
We lost you there.
Hello.
Yes, now we can hear you.
Should I go back to the last slide?
Yes. previous one and just the last statement.
The ground skimmer one.
Yeah. After the pond thing.
Yeah. So this is one of the commonest. So this is one of the commonest dragonflies. And I was saying, if your park in nearby area has a water body, or there is a water body nearby, then these dragonflies are so common, they can also wander away from the water body and come to the green grassy patches in your parks or societies. So this is one of the commonest dragonflies that we see around in urban areas. Then some more examples. This is a coral-tailed cloudwing. So most of the brightly colored dragonflies or damselflies are, most of them are males. And the females have dull colors. As in case of birds also, or butterflies also. So as you can see over here, why this is called as cloud wing, this is blue colored cloud shaped patch. That this is called as coral cloud wing. And this dragonfly is mostly active during evening times or evening hours of the day. So you might have seen these dragonflies coming to the tube lights near your homes or societies. And they stay over there overnight. And sometimes if their reproduction is over or the egg laying is over, by the morning they are dead. So these are this Crepuscular species, we can say. Then this one is another very excellent example of camouflaging. So if it is sitting on a, here you can make it out, but if it emerges with the surrounding habitat very well, and it is mostly seen around the rocks. And that's why this is called as night ghost. This one over here, the bottom left, is a black stream glider. Mostly it is found near the streams. That's why the name is also given like that. And overall, the body coloration is black. The green marsh hawk, the last one, is again very ferocious one. And it feeds on the smaller dragonflies, or sometimes the dragonflies of the size of size of the other dragonflies of its prey, which is bigger than its own body. Okay. Then there are some examples of clubtails. As you can see, there are patches of alternate patches of yellow and black. That's why these are called as clubtails. And most of the members of this family are having these color patches on their body. This one is a common tail. The male of this species and also the female, if you see over here, this is the longer part of this body is called as abdomen, and somewhat dilated structure is there. That's a characteristic of this species. And there is another species called as Macrocomphus over here, again found nearby the streams in forested areas. Mainly. Then there are darners. So blue darner, as the color suggests, its name. It's very big in size as compared to the other dragonflies. It is bigger in size, and it can be also found near the wells or the tanks which are built on forts. So many a times I have seen these dragonflies on the rocky surface. In those tanks. So this one, lesser green emperor, again it is active during the evening hours or during the night time more. So that's why I've used a flash to take his photograph. So that is another example of darner. And if you see, in case of darner, the eyes, both the eyes are completely fused. As in case of these ones, there is a slight gap over here or over here. So this is also one characteristic of their family to distinguish them. Coming to damselflies, so this is one of the smallest damselflies we have in India. This is called as pygmy dartlet. And another interesting thing about this damselfly is there is a lot of color variation among the individuals of this species. So this male is having this bright coloration, and the female of this species can be similar looking to the male, or it can be of a different color, or it can be of this red morph, reddish colored body.
Then we have golden ratlet, and then there are some dragonflies which are they have shades of blue and violets on their body. So mainly they are blue darts. Or in this case there is a three line dart over here. Some damselfly has really long abdomen, really long and thin abdomen. This part, the posterior part, and this is very longer as compared to the rest of the body. That's why they are bamboo tails. This family, and there are some smaller but very beautiful damselflies. And this family has some of the damselflies. The males of the damselflies have very very many colors on their wings. And these look very beautiful. So both these are female. The males are bright in color. Okay. So because they are present in both the environments, like the terrestrial environment as well as the aquatic environment, and there are many studies. People have studied their associations with the habitats. Like what habitats do they prefer, and what are the parameters, and what kind of forests they prefer to live in. So based on that, we can call them as habitat indicators. So there are some examples. So we saw the larva of this species. This is called a ditch jewel. So as it is found, it can be also found near polluted water. That's why the name is like that, ditch jewel. The male looks like this. The left image, and on the right hand side we have the female. It is more duller or less bright in color, and both the species were present in this kind of habitat. So this is one of the man-made tanks or man-made pond in Navi Mumbai. So as you can see, there is a lot of littering, and so if there is a lot of littering, you can guess that the ditch jewel can be present over here. So this is pollution tolerant species. It is not like that. It is every time it will be found over there, but it can tolerate that kind of environment. Okay, so an opposite kind of example. This is Malabar torrent dart, and this one is the male, and the bottom image is of female. So as you can see, the background is of a it's very much moist. It's very much slimy over there. These are found along the streams, basically the forested streams, and these will not be, you will not get them in urban areas or near the static water bodies or ponds and lakes. And that's why these only prefer forests, and that's why forest hill streams and water bodies related to the forests are very important. Then there are some other parameters, like some forest species also need, sometimes they need a closed canopy of trees. Sometimes they need open canopy where a lot of trees are not present. The habitat is not shady. So this is one of that. This is ruby-tailed hawklet, because this tail has this ruby color. That's why the male of this species is called like that. And this is particularly breeds in very sticky swamps areas. So some of you might not be familiar with the term Myristica swamps, but these are like specialized kind of plants or trees which are only found in certain patches, like in Western Ghats. You may found in central and southern Western Ghats. So they need high humidity, high rainfall areas. In such habitats, only these Myristica forests grow. And there are swamps associated with these habitats, and only in those swamps this species is yet seen to be breeding. Okay, so this is another indicator species. Okay, so after the indicator species, okay, so we will come to another part of their life cycle, that is breeding. So in case of dragonflies, the overall breeding or reproductive procedure is very intense. It is very competitive, basically. What happens is there is male rivalry, and if in pair, the male has mated with the female, and if it leaves the female and goes away, as then another male and mate again with that female, not just mate with the female, but it removes the sperm pouch of the earlier male and deposits its own, of its own. So that kind of competition, that kind of, you know, fight or rivalry is there in case of dragonflies and damselflies. So the male, every time till the egg laying is over, male guards the female so that his sperm pouch is not removed. So here it's a very peculiar way of breeding or mating in case of odonates. They form this heart-shaped structure or this closed loop. This is also very unique to these insects, and no other insects is known to form this. So this is a V sort of form. So this is a male, and the one on the lower side is a female. And over here, in case of male, there is a secondary genitalia. Basically, that's where they meet. So that's why a female is attaching its posterior end to this part of the male. Similarly, in damselflies, you can see over here. So it holds the female on its back or from the backside of the head, and they mate like this, forming a wheel closed loop structure. And as I said, there is a guarding by male, constant guarding. You can see over here, this is a blue donor pair. So the female over here, it is laying the eggs inside the water. And you can see the blue colored male above is guarding her, so no other male can come and steal her away till the old position is done. In another picture over here, so you can see male is still guarding her while she is laying the eggs. Okay, so there is one more thing. Dragonflies, most of the dragonflies just release their eggs into the water. Okay, that's this their strategy. And in case of damselflies, they insert their eggs into the plant. So they need aquatic vegetation. So this is an exception in case of dragonflies where the female inserts its eggs into some kind of plant tissue. Okay, so good picture of female blue darna. This is how it looks. And this is a aquatic plant in which she is laying the eggs. Basically, the females have a different part by which they give a cut to the plant and they insert the eggs. Okay, that was about breeding. So because there is so much of rivalry in case of males, in case of odonates, so females have also come up with different strategies so that they can be, you know, get escape from the males, because sometimes it happens that they get constantly chased by the males for mating. And that's why near the water bodies, mainly you will find the males and not the females. The females will be slightly away from the water body. Otherwise, males are territorial, and if they are nearby the water body, the male can grab the female and it can mate with it. So that's why the females kind of fake their death. So if they are chased by a particular male and they are not ready to mate, or they are not, or they already have mated, or for any kind of other reason, so they just try to be dead. It's a fake mechanism. Lots of other animals also show. So this is called as death feigning. And once the male thinks that the female is dead, it loses interest and it goes away, then the female can fly off. So this was not known until recent times. So this was published in 2017, as you can see here. So there is a lot of scope in case of these insects for the studies. The interesting part is migration, and let me tell you, this is the longest insect migration ever known. So in case of insects, the monarch butterflies, that species was supposed to be the species which migrates over a long distance. That was the longest migration in case of insects. But Pantella flavescens, this wandering glider, the common name is wandering glider. And because it migrates from across continents, that's what is also called as globe schema. So this pattern was discovered in about 2008-2009 when this scientist called as Charles Anderson observed this phenomenon. And at various localities, he appointed his volunteers just to see how this, is there a pattern in the migration or the flight of these dragonflies? And they found out, they came up with this result that every year along with the monsoon currents, basically these dragonflies, the pantelas, they come from Africa to India, and then when here in India when the monsoon is over, so by September or October, you can see over here. So from southern India, parts of southern India, it starts migrating back towards the eastern parts of Africa. And this cycle goes on. And in between, they make use of monsoon currents. They sometimes feed on the insects flying in the air. So this is one of the amazing phenomena of these dragonflies, because otherwise, such long distance migrations were only known in case of birds. But or the mammals, of course. But this is the first insect to show the, you know, up to 18,000 kilometers. The whole loop or the whole cycle is of that much of kilometers, and it involves multiple generations. Okay. So I think this should be the last slide. So there are various predators to dragonflies. This is one of the interesting photographs I wanted to show you. This is a great hornbill, and it is catching dragonflies, as you can see over here. It is sitting at the top of the tree. This photo was taken by Sandeep Kadur in Southern Western Ghats in Annamalais, if I'm not wrong. So he observed this natural history phenomenon that the hornbill was eating the dragonflies. Generally, hornbills are also known to feed on other lizards and the fig fruits. This is also a fig tree, and they assume that the dragonflies were there to, you know, eat smaller insects which feed on figs fruits, and that's why many dragonflies were there, and the hornbill was preying on the dragonflies. So that was another something very interesting phenomenon that was noted by this photographer. Okay. These are some of the books if anyone is interested, you know, take a more deeper look into the Odonate diversity by K. Subramaniam and Manoj Nair, sir. There are other publications also coming up in various journals, also Zootaxa and Journal of Threatened Taxa, about the new species that are coming up. But for starting, for beginners, these books are pretty good. So this is the study material. Otherwise, there are some more useful links I am sharing with Sagar already. So he'll be posting those links in the chat. You can go to those links and you can find more information about Odonate. There is an online portal where you can upload your observations called as Odonata of India. So in case of butterflies, iFoundButterflies.org is there. So it's a sister branch of that. You can upload your Odonata photographs on that website. It's a citizen science-based website. And there is also something I would like to share you. We have a network of Dragonfly South Asia. So some of us, the people who are Odonata lovers and watchers, they have come together and under diversity formed this group called as Dragonfly South Asia, through which we conduct yearly meetings to explore various areas in India in case of Odonates, and also we want to spread knowledge about this. So we conduct small talks and take you to field. So these are the other platforms if you want to know more about the Odonates. Okay. Yeah. So I'm done, Sagar.
Yes, thank you, Neha. Thank you very much for the wonderful session. And to everyone now, if you have any questions, please put up in the chat box. We will have 5 questions right now. And then later, if you have any questions, you can always email us regarding the same, and we will get back to you at earliest. Okay, yeah. So Neha, I will read out question one by one.
Yeah.
Lifespan of dragonflies.
Okay. It depends on various species. So the smaller size dragonflies, it generally varies from a month to 1 year or 2 years, because some of the longer or the bigger dragonflies may take time when they are in larval stages. So larval stage is the longest one. So from 1 month to 1 year or more than that, one or 2 years. If you consider from eggs to adult. If you just consider adult, then due to the natural reasons like praying or something, their lifespan is not very well studied. It's made of months, a few months or few weeks of animal life.
Thank you, Neha. And another question is ecological importance of dragonflies.
Okay. In one of the slides that I showed you that these damselflies and dragonflies feed on mosquito. So in case when they are in larval stages, they also feed on mosquito larvae. So they not only control the mosquito population when they are in larval forms, but also when they are in adult form. So adult dragonflies will eat along with other insects, they will feed on mosquitoes as well. And their larvae will eat the mosquito larvae, which are also there in the water. So in some sense, they check these population mosquitoes. That's one part. Second part is like that. I told you they're very habitat specific. Some of the species will only breed in forested hill streams, fast or slow flowing streams. But particularly in forest or the marshy lands, which are present in good forests, like in Western Ghats or Northeast part of India. So basically, where there are good patches of forest available, and you can also found in urbanized areas and ponds and lakes. So because they are habitat specific, that's how their presence or absence will tell you about the habitat, how good or bad or is the habitat. And also, if you study the water parameters in which they are living or in where you found them, where you find them. So by that, you can get to know the other parameters, like how is the dissolved oxygen or the pollution content of the water. Because many a times due to the agriculture, lots of pesticides and chemicals are, they're released into the water. So that can also have an effect on this these populations. Yeah, hope that answers your question.
The next question is there any other character for distinguishing the sex other than the colors?
Yeah, okay. Let me just hold that. So like I told you, other than the color, you cannot see here properly, but yeah. So in case of males, I told you there is a presence of secondary genitalia. That's a very prominent character. I'll show you where it is. This is the abdominal part. It starts from here to and it ends over here. These are total 10 segments, both in case of dragonflies and damselflies. So on the lower side, on the ventral side, over here, if you see, as compared to this segment is slightly bulgy because there is a presence of secondary genitalia over there, and it's a bulgy part. If you take a good photograph of a specimen or a dragonfly, and if you see this structure, small structure is always present on the lower side of the second segment of the abdomen. You need not count them always, but you can see them easily once you your vision is set. So this confirms that if it is a male or a female. And also on the 10th segment, because males need to hold the female by their back or backside of their head, there is a typical structure on the 10th segment that is called as anal appendages. So that is also very specific the structure is specific to males. That is present in case of males, and in females that is absent. So this is the quick way to confirm is the presence of secondary genitalia. I cannot share my screen right now, otherwise I would have showed that secondary genitalia part, but I hope you can see it over here. Right. Yeah, I hope that answers your question, Sagar.
Yes, Neha, thank you. And next one is, do the dragonflies position their wings in certain position based on the species?
Based on species? No, in general, as you can see, dragonflies spread out their wings and because, you know, also I told you that the wings are not of similar shape and size in case of dragonflies. So they cannot really hold back their wings and keep them on the back like these guys do, damselflies. So they usually spread out their wings. You take any example of a dragonfly. And in case of damselflies, there is one particular family that is called as spread wings. So generally, when other damselflies fold wings and keep on their back, the spread wings, as their name suggests, they kind of spread their wings and keep their wings as... okay, something like this, but on the, you know, towards the back or to posterior end. So they spread in the their wings at an angle. Sorry, I do not have the photograph right now to show you.
That's okay, Neha. I think that was pretty clear. And lastly, there is a request to repeat the mating process. I think there was a technical glitch at your side.
Okay. So there is a competition at a very high level in case of males, but between the males.